and more.
If you have a phone line, you can be online.
We've spent over $1 billion to create the world's largest high-speed network.
So easy my dad can use it.
America Online, so easy to use, no wonder it's number one.
Mitsubishi Montero Sport, nicely equipped at $24,950. Now available with 0.9% APR financing for 48 months.
We deliver great quality, time after time.
Same with Super 8.
Every room is comfortable. And roomy.
Super 8.
Super 8. Life's great at Super 8.
Sports Century's 50 Greatest Athletes, a year-long celebration. Number 39, Walter Payton. Friday at 10:30 on ESPN, presented by General Motors.
Back midway through the third round, and the name Cecil Collins still among just for talent. Your best left, Mel.
Well, the off-the-field concerns pushing him down the draft board. We're already into the latter portion of round three. Cecil Collins has been passed over for a lot of other running backs. Cameron Spikes, after his spectacular workouts prior to the draft, solid career at A&M. I thought he'd be off the board by this point. Poindexter, we know why he dropped from the knee injury. Team's wondering if he'll be ready to go for training camp and this season. Sean Bryson, I think, is an outstanding fullback. Good size now. He's up to about 230, 233. North-south runner, can catch the football. I'm looking for a fullback. This is a good shot spot for Sean Bryson. I was surprised Jermaine Bazan from Oklahoma went to San Diego, especially with Sean Bryson still on the board, Chris.
All right, well, those are some names we're looking for, but the name we've been talking about for quite a while, Cecil Collins, who obviously is a major gamble for reasons that that you just outlined. Some views on Cecil Collins, great potential on the field, who knows off, some views on him from around the league.
Well, I evaluate Cecil as a talented young player. He hasn't played enough football to be put in the upper echelon, but he might very well belong there. He's a troubled kid. He's made a lot of mistakes. It would be, I think, risky to take ownership's money and put it in the first round pick.
You're going to have to factor in the off the field issues, and you know, was this a young man who made some mistakes and he's maturing and going forward, or is this a person that you don't know what's going to happen? Can you make a judgment on how he'll be as you go forward?
It's amazing. I mean, I've talked to coaches that have coached Cecil Collins, and they said, boy, at practice and in the games, this guy is everything you want. And when we get into the NFL, you don't have control over them sometimes like you do in college, and they have money. I don't know how Cecil Collins is going to do.
Someone may find out here late in the third. He may be a name that we're looking at. Mel, what about him on the field, right? I mean, he's first-round ability?
Oh, great talent. Top 10 ability, Chris. You look at his size. You know, he's compact. He has tremendous breakaway speed. You know, productivity, certainly not there. He only played in six games. Here at McNeese State, two games there. You know, takes on traffic, moves outside, goes all the way. You're talking about a kid who has all the way potential. Anytime he touches the football here in the SEC against Mississippi State, another home run for the LSU offense. Cecil Collins had a remarkable game against Auburn as well, breaking tackles, going the distance. I mean, this kid is an awesome talent. You see it here again. Has that burst, has a nice change of pace to his running style, breaks tackles, nose for the end zone. Again, get inside the 10-yard line. Collins finds the end zone. And you look at Cecil Collins right now. We're into the third round, the latter portion of the third round. Four games at LSU. Of course, he had the broken ankle the one season. 8.3-yard average per carry. Speaks volumes about his home run hitting ability with three touchdowns. But I think when you look at Cecil Collins now, you go back to Lawrence Phillips. He was kind of rewarded with the off-the-field problems. He still went in the top 10 overall to St. Louis. Randy Moss dropped. So he came in knowing he had something to prove without all the big money that goes with being a top 10 pick. Cecil Collins now is at the point in the draft where he's not going to have that upfront money. He's going to have to earn his paycheck. So So he knows now that the NFL's not going to tolerate any off-the-field problems. He's not going to be rewarded for anything. He has to earn it. He has to prove all the doubters wrong. Maybe he does what Randy Moss did and gets everything in order and lives up to all that physical and athletic potential and that great natural running instinct he possesses.
You always root as a human being for somebody to be the best that he or she can. And certainly, Mike Tirico, we would root for Cecil like anybody else. We'd love to see him play kind of without all the shackles on him. I wonder if we'll have that chance, though.
Yeah, we might not, Chris. There are a lot of issues. I mean, you talk about second chances with players. Cecil's kind of beyond that from a legal standpoint. We'll just give you the quick legal history. He was at LSU and arrested twice, felonies and misdemeanors, then was eventually expelled from LSU after he was arrested for aggravated burglary on July 8th. Transferred, as you know, to McNeese State, tested positive for marijuana there in September, and that violated his bond agreement. 4 weeks in jail in Baton Rouge, a couple of months in a halfway house. At that point, he was expelled from McNeese State. Then in October, he was indicted on two counts of unauthorized entry to an inhabited dwelling and simple battery, Collins pleading innocent on that. And 10 days ago, he changed his plea to guilty. No jail time, 300 hours of community service. But as we've seen at the NFL draft before, one off-the-field issue that people can check out, they feel okay about. Several off-the-field issues, a bit of a concern. Thus, the reason Cecil Collins has high talent, but no draft pick so far. Well, Bill Cowher and the Pittsburgh Steelers are trying to bounce back from a non-playoff season. Let's hook up via Sprint video conference with the head coach of the Pittsburgh Steelers. And Bill, give me your forecast going into day one and how you've come out of it thus far. Are you happy with what's been there for you?
Well, I think so, very much so, Mike. I mean, we're in a situation, we still have one more pick, certainly, but I feel good about the four players that we have. I think we've done a good job in addressing some areas we wanted to address. You're looking at Troy Edwards, the receiver, Scott Shields, the safety that we wanted to get, we think can play the ball very well. And then in the third round, you get a guy like Chris Ferris, who's the Outland Trophy winner, and then a Joey Porter, who we think is a perfect fit for our 34 defense. So we think we've addressed some areas. I think we've got some good, productive football players.
Let me work on two of those players for a second. In Edwards and Porter, let's start with Edwards. The wide receiver position was one that we thought you guys would address. Were you hoping that a David Boston or a Holt would drop down? And did you talk at any point of moving up from the 13th spot where you took Edwards?
Well, we talked about a lot of different scenarios, and certainly I think when you looked at all three of the players, they're all three productive. But, you know, when you look at Troy Edwards, you got to be impressed by, number one, his production. But even number two, I think how he performed down the Senior Bowl said something about his ability to go to the next level.
Joey Porter in your system, others would see him as a tweener. Does he work perfectly for what you do defensively?
We think so. I think these are the type of players that we look at, I think, in the 34 that we maybe have a little bit of a benefit that we can get some of these guys. I mean, he's had a lot of production with sacks. I think you look at our players that we have with Chris Farron, the Outland Trophy winner, the interceptions of a Scott Shields. You know, we got some players, I think, that have been very productive in their college careers, and we do think Joey Porter is a good fit for our defense.
Charles Johnson, Carnell Lake, Darren Perry, great contributors to you over your years. You lose those guys. People talk about it as a trend of losing players, and you've addressed how the team must rebuild and must keep it going and have done it very well. Does it wear on you trying to kind of almost reinvent your core group year after year after year?
Well, I mean, it's always the challenge. I think, Mike, we're in a situation, I think, around the league. A lot of teams are going through that. We maybe went through it a lot earlier than some of the others did. But, you know, I think that's the challenge you have. And I think that's why it puts a great deal of importance on the draft and addressing areas you need to address. But there's still a very good core here. The expectations and the standards won't change. So we're kind of looking forward to next year.
And because of some of those free agency losses, you pick with a compensatory selection at the bottom of this round, number 95 overall. We'll let you get back in there. We look forward to that pick because that means we can go home and have a nice dinner.
We'll be quick, trust me, Mike, so we won't use our full 5 minutes.
We really appreciate that. Bill, we'll see you tomorrow. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks.
Bill Cowher, the coach of the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Tennessee Titans are on the clock. They are ready to select number 81 in the draft at 99. We continue from New York on a Saturday night after this.
Today's Sports Century Classic Moment is brought to you by Burger King.
NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle suspends Green Bay running back Paul Hornung and Detroit defensive tackle Alex Karras for gambling.
Pete made a right decision on the facts. It was a horrible mistake on my part. Everybody realized I wasn't the only one, and then poor Alex Karras.
I'm from a town where I've been betting all my life, so it doesn't occur to me that that's a big moral sin.
That was April 17th, 1963.